Blackstone Publishing presents The Death of Hitler's War Machine, The Final Destruction of the Wehrmacht, by Samuel W. Mitcham, Jr. This book is read by Grover Gardner. Introduction. The purpose of this book is to write the military history of Nazi Germany from the latter part of 1944 until May 23, 1945, the period in which Hitler's empire was finally and totally destroyed. From June 6, 1944 until early September 1944, Hitler's Wehrmacht was smashed on both the Eastern and Western fronts. It nevertheless made a desperate last stand and checked the Anglo-American armies in a series of battles along the Siegfried Line, while simultaneously administering a stinging defeat to the British Army at the Battle of Arnhem. At the same time, it almost miraculously created an entire new panzer army, which it unleashed in the Ardennes on December 16, 1944. It was Germany's last chance offensive, and it gave the Americans in particular some very bad moments. On the Eastern Front, the main focus was on Poland and Hungary. In August 1944, Romania defected from the Axis, and Germany lost most of its 6th and 8th armies. Hungary was wavering, and in September was invaded by the Soviet Union. Against seemingly overwhelming odds, Hitler's generals desperately tried to prevent the collapse of their southern flank. That they succeeded was one of the minor miracles of the war. This is where our story begins. Since 1960, there have arisen in the Western world what might be termed social military historians. They deal with war from a sociological, or in some cases, pseudo-sociological point of view, without discussing battles and campaigns, which are dismissed with a wave of the hand if they are mentioned at all. I believe war has its sociological and philosophical elements, but it also involves strategy, operations, and tactics, as well as logistics, training, the inclination of a people to wage war, and the warrior himself, be he general or private. In other words, this book will follow a more nuts and bolts approach, in which strategy, battles, and campaigns are emphasized, rather than sociological motivations. I wish to thank all those who helped in the researching, writing, and producing of this book, especially my wife Donna. Thanks also go to the archivists and other employees at the National Archives, Washington, D.C., the Bundesarchive, the War College, the Center of Military History, and the Imperial War Museum, as well as the late Friedrich von Stauffenberg, and anyone else who shared information, advice, photographs, or memoirs with me. Dr. Samuel W. Mitcham, Jr., Monroe, Louisiana, February 2020. Chapter 1. Setting the Stage. The Nazis came to power on January 30, 1933. At that time, Germany lived under the restrictions imposed by the Treaty of Versailles, which ended World War I. Its military force, the Reichswehr or armed forces, was limited to 115,000 men, 100,000 in the army, Reichsheer, and 15,000 in the navy, Reichsmarine, which left Germany unable to defend itself or threaten its neighbors. Adolf Hitler changed all that, and he had an excellent foundation upon which to build. The notoriously efficient general staff was officially abolished in 1919, but its de facto replacement, the Truppenamt, troop office, secretly continued to train top-level general staff officers. Germany also continued to maintain its Wehrkreise, sometimes spelled Wehrkreisen, or German military districts, which were the heart of the German army. Each Wehrkreis was a corps-level territorial command responsible for recruiting, mobilization, supply, administration, logistical support, and all military, political, and military civilian matters within its area. After Hitler renounced the Treaty of Versailles, the Wehrkreise were responsible for implementing conscription for the German army.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.